Well, as this year continues to absolutely fly by, here we are looking forward to Halloween this weekend. There's also, you know, November coming up. Next thing you know, it's going to be the UAE National Day long weekend. And to get more details, for anyone who is looking to travel and get some ideas on new countries to travel to or what are the best places to travel to, is one of the most experienced journalists in the region, Abhishek Sengupta, who has travelled to over 45 countries, and to give us more thoughts. So thank you very much for joining us on Talk 100.3.
Good day, Kitch. Should I use my Aussie twang for you?
What it sounds like, that's a, what is that, a Russian accent? What are you doing?
Well, it's mixed up after traveling so much. But yeah, I wanted to do the Aussie thing. Now, I haven't been to Australia. That's one big country missing on my map.
Well, it's a long way. I always tell people, if you do want to speak like an Australian, you just have to turn one sentence into one word. So you say, "Hey, yeah, mate, you going all right?" You just have to mumble a bit more. Mumble a bit more to be Australian. But, I mean, this year's flying by. Here we are getting into the National Day break. And it's a good excuse if you're not going to be hanging around here or going to Spartan or going to the Rugby Sevens or doing any of the big activities that are on. What tend to be some of the most popular destinations to travel to over this weekend?
I think the most popular destinations have been the former CIS countries, the Armenians, the Georgias, the Azerbaijans, particularly because it's very easy to get into those countries because obviously they're looking at a tourism boost, and that's why they've opened up the country. So getting visa is very, very easy. For us, especially Indians, you get visas on arrival. So that's one headache taken out of the way. And of course, rest of Europe, a lot of people travel to Turkey. Getting a visa to Turkey is also easy because now you all get it online. So e-visa for Indians. Some of us also like to fly to, let's say, Kenya and other African destinations. So pretty much places which is within a three-hour flight range from Dubai.
Yeah, 3 to 4 hours is always a good time when you factor in getting to the airport and security. It works out very, very well. For anyone who is looking to get to a visa-free country, you mentioned those nations around Georgia and Azerbaijan are always popular. I mean, because they are stunning countries. Yeah. But is it anyone with an Indian passport can get in, or just those that have a UAE visa?
Now, I was, in fact, just to sort of be factually correct and politically correct, I was actually checking, and I did find out that Indians can actually get visas on arrival.
So okay.
You don't have to be a resident of the UAE. Okay. But yes, being a resident of the UAE helps sort of other nationalities. Let's say a Pakistani living in the UAE can get equally easier access to these countries.
When it comes to traveling to a lot of places, I mean, you've been to 45 different countries. When you're looking for a place to stay, what do you recommend? Yeah. Do you recommend doing, you know, the all-packaged holiday? Do you often recommend to maybe do the hotels or Airbnb? Or does it really depend on the country you're going to?
It does. In fact, I've flown to so many places, but the only time I've done a packaged holiday was just earlier this year when we went to Armenia. Now, it's got its pluses and minuses, of course. When you are on a packaged trip, you don't have to worry about too many things because everything is sorted for you. But when you're on your own, then, of course, you've got to worry. You have to spend a considerable amount of time trying to find the cheapest sort of place to live. Not really necessarily the cheapest, but the best and the most cost-effective manner. So that takes a bit of time and research. So I would recommend it. Depends on the place. I mean, the last time I was in Russia during the World Cup, you know, finding a hotel was very, very expensive, as you can imagine. It's the same case now in Qatar. If you are planning to go to the World Cup,
it's nearly impossible. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. So what I did was in Russia, thankfully. Unlike what's happening in Qatar now, where all hotels are through a centralized booking agency under the Qatar Organizing Committee, Russia opened its doors to a lot of tourists who could stay in dorms and hostels. So that's also a way of life when you're traveling, and I would recommend you should do that once in a while. So I remember when I was in Russia, I actually spent about 4 nights spending about 35 dirhams per night, and you couldn't have a better deal than that. Then I've stayed in a place in St. Lucia, which went for over $5,000 per night. So, you know, so it's interesting. It all depends on the country that you are in.
And also who you're traveling with. I can't agree more. I spent a bit of time in Europe this summer, and I thought, I'll just book as I go. But then you'll spend the four-hour train trip looking up places rather than enjoying the scenery and just taking in the moment. In the same way that's really great advice when you're looking to book a hotel. You might think, oh, this place is a lot cheaper. It's only a little bit out of town. But when you factor in the cost of a cab or a train or the time lost going back and forth, it's cheaper in the end to get the expensive hotel close to the center of town.
Exactly. And in fact, I recommend if you're in Europe, it's the hub of public transportation. Any city that you go to in Europe is well connected. You can hop onto a bus, a metro. Sometimes you can rent a bike. So I suggest the best way of sort of, you know, exploring Europe is to stay in a hotel that's close to a metro station or a tube station, as you would say in London.
Yeah.
And that's very easy to commute. You just have to hop onto a metro and you pretty much reach anywhere you want to in that particular city.
You know, there's a lot of places that people like to travel to, and especially in the UAE, places like Sri Lanka and the Maldives do tend to see their prices increase. What countries do you think provide the best value for money during the UAE National Weekend?
I would say Istanbul, Turkey. Mm-hmm. Turkey has been very, very popular for many reasons. It's got very affordable flights, and there are many options from a Pegasus to Turkish Airlines to Emirates. So when you have many options to fly, it definitely makes it more affordable, opens that place for more and more people. And it's got very, very affordable hotels, and food is very interesting, very cheap as well. So I think all of those factors make In my mind, Turkey, very, very affordable. Sri Lanka, yes, but again, Sri Lanka is not a place I would recommend you go with a package tour so everything is taken care of. Same with Maldives, because Maldives is, you're literally sort of pigeonholed into the hotel that you've booked up with for the next 7 days or 4 days. There's not much to sort of roam around like a city in Europe. So it depends.
I have heard that from many people that have thought they've got great deals in going to the Maldives, and then they've realised when they get there's nowhere else to eat but the hotel, and the prices of food and drink are absolutely extortionate.
Exactly.
Yeah.
The same with Mauritius and other countries like that.
Yeah, that is a great point as well. You know, when it comes down to other than hotels, and also when it comes down to other than just the hotels, and you're looking at staying at other places, you know, I really do think that sometimes those dormitory and backpackers, if you've got your own room, can be a good place to socialise and meet other people. What are your views on Airbnbs? Are they always a good option, or is it always just a case of you might get a good room, you might get unlucky with your reviews?
Yeah, but I think you do get lucky more often than not, because personally, I haven't tried Airbnb, but I've recommended and I've heard stories of people using, and they've been pretty good, interesting stories. And like you said, they open up to sort of meeting people from other cultures. So you make friends at the end of the day. And that, I mean, I had a similar experience in Estonia and Latvia many years ago. Airbnb wasn't that big, but if it was today, I would have probably gone the Airbnb route using the same accommodation.
Well, they're great tips, as always. Abhishek Shengupta is a journalist and travel enthusiast, giving us some tips with the UAE national break coming up soon. Where's next? Where's next on your agenda? Where are you off to?
I wish I could afford a holiday right now with the work schedule so busy. November, December, a lot of cricket coming up. I'm actually craving a window where I can actually plan. But yes, one country that I really want to visit is Serbia, because A, you get visas on arrival. B, it's very, very close. And C, it's got very affordable flights from here.
And four, it's pretty cheap when you get there.
It is, absolutely.
Number
five, I wanted to go to the former Yugoslavia, and I haven't been there. That's one big chunk of countries that's missing on my map. And I think Serbia is a very good place to start with. Belgrade, the former capital of Yugoslavia anyway.
No, I think that Eastern Europe is so untouched compared to, in many ways, Western Europe, that there's so much, a lot more history and culture that you can really soak up. Abhishek Sengupta, thank you very much for sharing your thoughts this afternoon.
Thanks, Kitch. Thanks a lot for talking.
Yeah, good to have a chat. So there he is, the travel enthusiast, 45 countries he's been to, giving some tips in regards to the UAE national break coming up. Where is that one place that you'd love to get to? 0586861003. Where would you love to travel to next? Are you going away for the national break? Or are you maybe staying here doing a staycation and taking in some great offers? Let us know your thoughts. 0586861003.